Good morning. Our scripture passage is Romans chapter 14. We're going to look at verses 13 through 23. That's the second half of the chapter. And you'll remember from last week, we began with this issue of the weak and the strong, and an issue that was evidently troubling many in the church at Rome. Those who were weak still had probably a number of them were Jewish believers who still had the guidance of the law, its dietary rules governing their thinking. And the strong were those that knew they weren't under the law any longer and weren't bound by those rules, and there was a conflict between them. The weak considered the strong not very righteous because they weren't living up to the standard they had for themselves, and the strong were judging the weak as being immature and not understanding their freedom. So this is the issue that Paul has been dealing with, and he continues with it in the second half of the chapter, beginning with verse 13. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way. I know and am convinced in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but to him who thinks anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. For if because of food your brother is hurt, you are no longer walking according to love. Do not destroy with your food him for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let what is for you a good thing be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who in this way serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then, we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another. Do not tear down the work of God for the sake of food. All things indeed are clean, but they are evil for the man who eats and gives offense. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or to do anything by which your brother stumbles. The faith which you have as your own conviction before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith, and whatever is not from faith is sin. May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's bow in a word of prayer. In one of his sermons, St. Augustine said, "Love and do what you will." That is freedom. And as Paul told the Galatians, it was for freedom that Christ set us free. But there's nothing in either Paul's statement or Augustine's that suggests Christian liberty is license. It is the opposite. Love does not seek its own or rejoice in unrighteousness. So if we follow Augustine's advice, we will live moral lives and sacrificial lives, sacrificing even our liberty when the situation requires it. That's what love does. So all through this second half of Romans 14, Paul advises the strong Christian, the person who understands his or her freedom, to practice it with love by showing restraint. That's what he advises in verse 13. Determine this, he says, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way. He's referring to the non-essential or debatable things from earlier in the chapter, things like eating meat or not observing special days, not observing the Sabbath as some might have felt it should be observed. For us, it might be other things. It might be taboos like drinking wine or watching football on Sunday. In regard to Christians who have scruples, who have convictions about such things, Paul says, don't do anything that would harm their walk. He repeats that in verse 21. Don't do anything by which your brother stumbles. And that is the basic lesson, the basic exhortation of this passage, the second half of Romans 14. And by it, Paul means, don't set an example that might influence a person to sin by doing something that is against his or her conscience. Be responsible in the use of your liberty. Consider what the effect of doing it, of practicing your liberty, might have on others. Bishop Mole said, be severe with self, gentle with others. Now, in verse 14, Paul acknowledges the fact of Christian liberty and the Christian's right to practice it and enjoy it. He writes, I know and am convinced in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself. Paul's likely referring here to the teaching of our Lord in Mark chapter 7, verses 14 through 19, where it is stated that Jesus declared all foods clean. No food is evil. Food is morally neutral. The idea that certain foods or drinks are inherently evil is not a Christian idea. The Quran, for example, prohibits wine and teaches that there is a devil in every berry of the grape. The Bible doesn't teach that. Just the opposite. Paul told Timothy, everything created by God is good. Grapes are good. So the strong are right in their understanding of the Christian's relationship to food and their freedom to eat and drink. But Paul adds to the person who thinks something is unclean, like a Jewish convert who has come out of a strict discipline of what he can wear and what he can eat, a kosher diet where certain things are forbidden and forbidden very strictly. When a person like that has come out of such a situation, then to him who has this idea that it's wrong to eat pork and he has not advanced beyond that, then to him, if he thinks it's unclean, it is unclean. He cannot eat it. And those who understand their liberty need to understand that about their situation. Not everybody is the same. One of the features that we see about the church is there's great diversity in the church. There's diversity of experience, of background. There's diversity of gifts. We don't all have the same gifts. We don't all have the same level of understanding. The understanding that some have, which is an advanced understanding, is a gift of God. He's opened their hearts. He's brought them along. And with others, it's not quite that way. And so we need to be aware of that. The strong, I think this is Paul's exhortation here, the strong need to be aware of that, need to be understanding of that, so that they won't bring about another person's spiritual downfall by insisting on exercising their freedom to eat or drink. Verse 15, Paul gives the reasons that is wrong and the reasons for acting with restraint in the use of our freedom. And the first has to do with love. It's not an act of love if our behavior influences a person to follow an example that will violate his or her conscience. Now, I had a professor in seminary, a godly man, who had strong views on alcohol. He was lecturing one time and was in the class on 1 Corinthians 13, the chapter of love, and he said that a person who drinks alcohol, he might have said wine, but a person who drinks an alcoholic beverage cannot love. And then he repeated that. He cannot love. Now I thought, really? Jesus' first miracle was changing water into wine and the best wine. But this man was adamant on that subject and wrong. And I didn't drink wine, but still, if I had, I wouldn't have drunk the wine in front of him. He would have kicked me out of school if I'd done that. But also, out of respect for him, I wouldn't have done that. And I wouldn't have wanted to offend him. I had great respect for him. Now, that's how we often think of this issue that Paul is speaking of here, about not offending people. Paul is not speaking about not offending a mature Christian. What he's speaking of here is influencing a weaker person to do what we do, to eat or drink when that person is not quite sure if it's right or wrong or has a conviction that it is wrong. We're influencing that person to do that. Well, we may have a right to eat or drink, but if by practicing our freedom we trample on another person's convictions, then Paul says we are no longer walking according to love. The second reason we should be glad to restrict our freedom is the death of Christ. Do not destroy with your food him for whom Christ died. Since Christ loved this other believer, this weaker believer, enough to give his life for him or her, we should be willing to give up our freedom for that individual. Since Christ died for his or her well-being, we're to avoid hurting that person. In fact, Paul puts the threat of harm in a very strong language with the word destroy. Do not destroy with your food him for whom Christ died. Now, that doesn't mean that we might, by our example, cause a brother or sister to indulge, violate their conscience, and perish eternally. That's not what Paul is saying. That would contradict everything that he has written. That's not possible to do that. We know that from Romans chapter 8, verses 28 down through verse 39, but specifically in verse 39, we're having listed all of these possibilities. Says that there's nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. We can't separate anyone from God's love, and nothing will separate us from God's love in Jesus Christ. We cannot lose our salvation. The word destroy here has a wide range of meaning beyond the idea of perdition. It does mean that in some places, but it has a wider range of meaning than that. And here it's to be understood as the opposite of building up, of edifying, which in verse 19, Paul says, we're to pursue. We're to pursue building each other up. We're to pursue peace. So what Paul is warning against is misleading a sensitive conscience by a careless or a reckless use of our spiritual liberty. Our example can be harmful. And because the consequences are so serious, Paul gives some strong advice in verse 16. Do not let what is for you a good thing be spoken of as evil, or literally spoken of as evil is blasphemed. So that's more strong language on the part of the apostle. What is for a good thing, what is for you a good thing, is a debatable expression. In other words, there's a lot of division about what it means. The context, I think, would suggest that he's speaking here of Christian liberty. But what might argue against that is that this is generally being stated to the weak and the strong as well. And what this Paul literally says is the good. Don't let the good be blasphemed. Well, the good could, as I say, mean your liberty, but it could be something more general than that, that applies to all, weak and strong alike, and how they respond to this situation, so that it refers to the gospel. And I rather think that is his meaning. So don't let the gospel be maligned by an improper use of freedom. And by implication to the weaker Christian, by criticizing those that don't follow their way of life. We are responsible to look out for each other. We're responsible for the welfare of others. And to guard in that way our Christian testimony. We don't do that when we offend someone or influence him or her to violate their conscience. The solution to that is understanding the cross of Christ and understanding the kingdom of God. And that should motivate us to put the weaker brother or sister first. That's what Paul appeals to in verse 17. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of God is the realm of God's rule and the realm to which all believers belong. And all believers belong equally and fully. It will become manifested on the earth in the future reign of Christ, but it exists as a present reality in the church, since God rules within us and He's working out His will in His people. We are citizens of the kingdom now. Paul puts it a little differently to the Philippians. In Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20, he reminds them that their citizenship is in heaven. And he preceded that by explaining they need to walk in a worthy way, in a proper way. And you do that by remembering who you are. You're a citizen of heaven. You're a citizen with the kingdom of God as the principles that govern you. And in the Holy Spirit, we enjoy the blessings of God and His rule. The blessings of God's kingdom are not food and drink and material things. I don't want to imply by that those aren't gifts of God. They certainly are, and they're to be enjoyed. But the essence of the kingdom doesn't come down to the physical things. It's the spiritual. It's as he puts it here, righteousness and peace and joy, meaning justification, reconciliation, and the joy of the Holy Spirit. Food perishes, but righteousness, our justification, our salvation is permanent. And these are the things that are to be elevated in our mind and that join us together with one another. Not non-essential things that don't last and really don't matter to God. I think this applies to both the weak and the strong. They're to have a proper understanding of the kingdom of God. The weak Christian needs to understand that because a person's life and value in the kingdom isn't measured by what he or she does or doesn't drink or eat, but not measured by the things that a person denies himself. So often I think that is what in the mind of some Christians, and it's in some ways a cultural thing, but that's how they view spirituality and maturity, by what isn't done. That's not how we judge ourselves. And the strong need to understand that material things and the enjoyment of food and drink is not all that important and shouldn't be allowed to become an issue of division or harm in the church. Those who let it become that, who put food or pleasure ahead of the welfare of the weak, don't understand the kingdom. They certainly aren't living according to its values and seeking it. All of this is a problem of perspective, of getting our priorities straight and learning what is really important and what isn't important. Righteousness, peace, and joy are what the kingdom of God is about, meaning it is about grace. Everyone in God's kingdom, everyone whose citizenship is in heaven has been accepted by God and received by Him because of the work of Christ and the work of Christ alone. And so we're to be accepting of everyone for whom Christ died. We're to be rejoicing in our salvation, not judging or criticizing one another, not worrying about non-essential matters, but making known the important things, God's righteousness and peace, and rejoicing in that. And that is what should give us joy. I think the pursuit of the knowledge and the practice of those things, the pursuit of the knowledge of God's grace or of righteousness. And I think when he's speaking speaks of righteousness here, he's not speaking so much of the practice of righteousness, but the righteousness that's imputed to us. That's the consistent use of the word throughout the book of Romans. So understanding your justification, that you have been declared righteous and you are fully accepted by God, that you've been reconciled with Him, you have peace with God, and that issues in great joy as one understands that you have a new relationship with God and with man. And as one focuses on that, that is what should give us joy and perspective on life, not these non-essentials that are really not that important. May seem important to us at the time, but they're not. Well, they certainly weren't to Paul. His life did not consist of material things. He told the Philippians that he had learned to be content with much or with little. Either way, he was happy. I don't doubt that when he was given much, when he visited someone who was able to provide richly for him, he enjoyed it, enjoyed the good things of life. But when he was deprived of that by God's providence, whatever circumstance that might have been, and he was deprived of it quite a bit, he lived a hard life, he was still content because he knew his life wasn't bound up in things. It was tied to the person and work of Christ. He understood righteousness and peace and had joy as a result of that. That's what's important. That's what was important to the Apostle Paul. So he could live in whatever circumstance he was in. He could live as under the law or free from the law, depending on what the circumstance was. He would adjust to that. What he cared about was furthering the work of God and building up the church and expanding it. Doing that is what the Lord encouraged us to do in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. That is serving Christ. That is how we seek his kingdom and the things of the kingdom. And that is what Paul advises in verse 18. When we do that, he says, when we seek the things of God, when we seek that first and foremost, we are acceptable to God and approved by men. Serving Christ is what pleases God. Not worrying about diets or insisting on our freedoms. And if we serve Christ faithfully, we will not only please God, but we'll gain the approval of men, Paul says. The world will oppose us. We should expect that. It's going to oppose us for standing for the truth. It's going to oppose us for the gospel. But when we live consistent lives, when we live obedient lives, as Jesus did, loving, joyful lives, sacrificial lives, then the world cannot accuse us of hypocrisy. That's the idea here. The word approved, being approved by men, means tested. It was used of testing metals to determine whether coins were genuine currency or fake currency, counterfeit. So by our behavior, we prove ourselves in the eyes of the world to be real, to be genuine. They can't bring a charge against us, at least not a legitimate charge against us, of being hypocrites or something like that. And in so doing, in living a consistent life, a loving life, a sacrificial life, looking out for the other believer and his or her good, well, that might gain the world's respect and in so doing gain the world's interest. They may give attention to us and say, they're worth listening to, they're genuine, this is real. But we do that not by seeking to please the world, but by seeking to please God and serve Christ. When we do that first, when we, to put it in a different way, seek God's glory above all things, seek God's interests and the interests of His work above our own personal interests, then all of these other things will take care of themselves. God will provide richly for us. All of this being so, Paul tells us to pursue peace in verse 19 and seek to build up one another. The kingdom of God is characterized by peace, and its citizens ought to seek that and promote peace. Paul is more direct in verse 20, and again, he's speaking here to the strong. Do not tear down the work of God for the sake of food. All things indeed are clean, but they are evil for the man who eats and gives offense. Well, all of this has been stated before, and you might be thinking, this is a bit repetitive. And I think it is. Paul keeps coming back to this, the same points. But the fact that Paul repeats his instruction here on how we're to behave, the strong toward the weak, shows the importance that he placed upon it. We are not to be fighting over things that are not essential. We're not to be dividing over these things. That's destructive of God's work. And the work of God is the church. That is what he is building in this age. That's important to him. You are important to him. This place, this body, this institution here is important to him. But its unity is damaged when the strong hurt the weak by insisting on the exercise of their Christian liberties of eating and drinking. And once again, Paul doesn't question the right of the strong to eat whatever they want. All things indeed are clean, he says. There are no devils in the grapes. Everything is clean. Still, when the strong person eats carelessly or callously with disregard for the other and gives offense, then food becomes evil for that person, for the strong person. So for the sake of strength and peace in the church, a person should gladly make personal sacrifice and refrain from eating and drinking. A story is told of Charles Spurgeon. I've heard this, I've read this, that at the height of his popularity, and at the height of his popularity, he was popular worldwide, not only in the English-speaking world, but all over the globe. Every week they'd send his sermons out all over the world. At the height of that, Mr. Spurgeon was walking down the street and he saw a sign that read, "We sell the cigars that Charles Spurgeon smokes." And when he saw that, he gave up smoking. He didn't want to make anyone stumble. And that was good. And I'll bet his wife really loved him for it. But this raises a question in all of this, and that is, what does it say about yielding to legalism? Because there is such a thing as the tyranny of the minority, or the in this case, the tyranny of the weak, and we can come under that if we yield to their taboos for the sake of peace. It's almost like peace at any price. Ray Stedman, who was for many years minister, the teacher at the Peninsula Bible Church in Palo Alto, California. He's now with the Lord, but he wrote a nice commentary on the book of Romans, and he pointed out that that happens, this tyranny of the weak, when the question of Christian liberty is settled, as he put it, on the basis of the most narrow and most prejudiced person in the congregation. And ultimately, that doesn't help the cause of Christ. That may give some peace, but that sets a precedent and a standard that's not good, because then the gospel becomes identified with that view. And Christians are perceived to be narrow-minded people whose aim is to prevent the enjoyment of God's good gifts, which have been given bountifully for us to enjoy. That attitude, that narrowing of our views on things, of being governed by the the week and being governed by a system of do's and don'ts reminds me of a definition that the journalist H.L. Mencken gave of Puritanism. I've given this before, but Mencken was a very popular journalist in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, and he was not a believer. He had no sympathy for Christianity, none for Puritanism, and he said that Puritanism is the haunting fear that someone somewhere may be happy. And that isn't true. He didn't understand Puritanism because the Puritans thoroughly enjoyed life and lived better lives than those around them and knew how to do that. But I think for many that is what they think of as Puritanism, or how they would define Calvinism today. Most people don't understand Calvinism, and they don't define it so much as according to the doctrines of Calvinism. Well, they may hold on to predestination, but to them that's fatalism. And the Calvinists are the people that dress darkly and they live severe, dour lives. That really is how people think of them. I know particularly in Europe it is. But that's the impression that people have, I think, of Christianity. It's severe and joyless, and the reality is it does become that when legalism prevails, when the weak rule, as it were. Paul was very much against that. He taught joy. He taught freedom in Christ and that we should enjoy it. And he warned the weak against judging the strong for doing what they are free to do. God's kingdom, he taught, is characterized by spiritual and eternal truths. It's not about food and drink. The implication is the weak are not to make prohibitions on them. Prohibitions on all of these things, a measure of righteousness. So he has touched on the problem of potential legalism, but Paul doesn't deal with every angle of this issue in this passage. He's relating his teaching to a given situation. Here it is the abuse of freedom and the injury that it causes to the weak. So I assume from this that Paul had some insight or some knowledge about what was going on in the Church of Rome that he hopes to come and visit. And he's explaining, don't deal with these weak people harshly. And he had sympathy for them because most of them were probably Jewish converts. And he understood what they were going through, the changes that they had faced with the change of diet or the release from the diets of the Old Testament that had been so binding on them. And so he didn't want them to be injured. He had a special concern for them. That's what he's dealing with here. And so to prevent that, the strong should avoid eating or drinking or whatever might cause a weaker person to stumble. That doesn't mean that they couldn't eat at other times. They could, they should. But in a situation where it would cause a weaker brother to stumble, they shouldn't do that. Paul's given three rules guiding their behavior. If I can kind of sum up what he said so far. And the first rule is do no harm. Love doesn't do that. Love sacrifices. So that's the first principle, the first guideline that he set down. Do no harm. And the second is live as a citizen of the kingdom. Don't be guided in your thinking by mundane things like food and drink and your right to eat and drink when you want. Be guided by the higher principles of the kingdom of God: righteousness, peace, joy. And thirdly, benefit others. Promote peace. Promote their edification. Do no harm. Promote the good, is what he's saying. Live by higher principles. Those are the three guidelines that he's given so far. And now he concludes the chapter with a fourth guideline by calling attention to the role of conscience, the role that it plays in guiding our behavior. He speaks first to the strong and then he speaks to the weak. In verse 22, he advises the strong Christian not to parade his faith. He says, he is to have it as, that is, his faith, his conviction, as his own conviction before God. Now, Paul here is not speaking of saving faith. He's not telling the strong to be quiet about the gospel, obviously. That's not his point. He's speaking of the faith that enables the strong believer to know and enjoy his freedom. He's not to make a show of that. That doesn't mean he can't explain his views to the weak believer. He can, and probably, I think the implication would be, he should do that. That's how the weak is going to become strong. Paul wants that to happen. He wants the weak to become stronger, and so they will become stronger as they learn the truth. And it's the Word of God that gives us strong faith. So he's certainly not prohibiting that. But there's a right way to do that, and that is with consideration for the feelings of others. He's not to flaunt his freedom. He's to hold on to his freedom and enjoy it, but always remember that he practices his freedom before God, which should keep him from turning his liberty into license. Then Paul adds a blessing on the person who does that. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves, which means that he is blessed because he eats or drinks with a clear conscience. And he has a clear conscience because he acts from conviction. He knows the liberty that God has given him, and his practice of it is from faith. But in verse 23, Paul warns weak Christians that if they act against what they believe, but he who doubts condemns himself because his eating is not from faith, and whatever is not from faith is sin. So if he contradicts his conscience, he's committing sin, the weak believer. And a sin here is defined as in its essence as unbelief of God's word, contradicting or not believing what your conscience convicts you of doing. And so his condemnation occurs not because he has eaten or drunk something. Food and drink are morally neutral. What condemns him is that he did it with doubts. He felt that this is wrong, but he did it anyway. Even though what he does is permissible, speaking of the weak person here, even though his convictions may not be altogether correct, he's not mature in his understanding of his relationship to food and drink, still, if he does that, if he's influenced by the strong to partake in something that his conscience says is not right, then he's not acting in faith, and so it is sin. British commentator Charles Cranfield put it this way: a neutral thing only becomes a right thing when it is done out of faith, out of real reasoned conviction that it is the right thing to do. The only motive for doing anything is that a man believes it to be right. When a thing is done out of social convention, out of fear of unpopularity, to please men, then it is wrong. So conscience is a guide in some of these matters. Not an infallible guide, but it is a God-given guide, and to go against it is sin. Now remember, we're talking here, and the context is the neutral things, not specific things that have been stated as sin, but disputable things, like honor the days of the week. Do we have one above another? Do we treat every day alike, or food or drink? These are the kinds of things that conscience bears upon. And so this is a warning to the weak, but it's also a message to the strong. They should not influence the weak to violate their conscience by eating or drinking or breaking, probably shouldn't say breaking the Sabbath, but not observing the Sabbath, or doing whatever they, the weak, think is wrong. Their faith must first be strengthened and enlightened. And the way that is done is not by pushing them into things that they're not ready to do, but simply by praying and instructing and being patient with them. Then, hopefully, by the work of the Spirit of God in them, they can join the strong in the enjoyment of their Christian liberty. But that takes time. It takes patience. To do that, we need to walk with them at their pace, just as we would walk with a child. You remember how, if you're a parent, you taught your children to walk. You didn't walk out in front of them and keep your own pace. You went at their pace. Maybe you held their hand. You taught them patiently how to walk. And when they fell, you were there to help them up. But you didn't outpace them. And so too, when we live with the weak, the strong are to be the same. They're to be patient. We don't desert the weak for the sake of our own pleasure, for the sake of our own liberty. We don't abandon them in order to enjoy what we have. We keep pace with them and help them along. We don't abandon our liberty at the same time, but we don't abuse it. And so we do all of that by keeping our eyes on the goal with the right motivation. Paul speaks of that in verse 15, walking according to love. That's how we do it. And we do that by looking to Christ. He's the object of our faith, always. Our saving faith, our sanctifying faith, He's the object of faith. He's our model, He's our motive, He's our law. He is God Almighty, but He is gentle with the weak. It was said of Him that a battered reed He would not break and a smoking wick He would not put out. He's the Son of God, but became the servant of men. And that's what we are called to be. Martin Luther understood that and understood very well our Christian liberty. He wrote, "A Christian man is a most free lord of all and subject to none." But then in the next sentence he wrote, "A Christian man is a most dutiful servant of all, subject to all." And Paul would have agreed with that. That's his lesson in this chapter. We are free, but our freedom makes each of us a servant of all. We are free and subject to none, as Luther said. We are free from man's rules and taboos, but we are also free to observe them when doing so is a service for others. Believers are as free to say no as they are free to say yes. Free to say no to the things of the old covenant law and its principles of diet, as we are free to say, yes, I'll observe those things. It's as we consider Christ, who He is and what He's done for us by dying in our place, as we consider that, we will want to please Him and be a blessing to the person for whom He died. Christ had a special concern for the weak. He invited them to come to Him. "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Are you weighed down with guilt? Are you weighed down with your sins? Then come to Christ. He has taken all of that on Himself. He bore our sins on the cross and punished them in our place. So now, believe in Him. Trust in Him. Come to Him. That's what He invites you to do. And the moment one does that, he or she is forgiven and given eternal life. That person, that believer, is made free from the power and the penalty of sin. That's real freedom. So may God help you to come and enter into that freedom if you have not. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your goodness to us. We thank You that, that we genuinely are free. And we are men and women who can enjoy the good things that You have given in such abundance in this world, certainly in our part of the world. But we're not free to injure people, and we need to know and have that kind of wisdom, Father, that we would sacrifice the freedoms that we have in order to be a blessing to others. So Lord, enable us to be that kind of people, those who love and love in such a way that we make the sacrifices we need to. We can do that in the power of the Spirit, and we pray for that, and we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.